Okay, so welcome back everyone to the second lecture of the morning session. So it's my pleasure to introduce Alberto De Sole now, who's going to be talking about vertex algebra and Poisson vertex algebra cohomology.
Thank you very much. So first of all, everything I'm going to say is part of a joint project with Bosco Bacalov, Raimundo Eluani, and Victor Katz. So I've been taught that the first thing one says in a talk should be known to everybody in the audience, so I will start with something that I'm sure everybody knows, which is definition of a Lie algebra. Definition, a Lie algebra. I will denote it by V. It's a vector space with Lie bracket. Satisfying skew-symmetry and Jacobi identity. And then the notion of Lie algebra comes with the so-called Chevalier-Eilenberg cohomology complex. The Lie algebra cohomology complex is defined as follows. The kth space of the cohomology. I will talk about cohomology with coefficients. One can talk about cohomology with coefficients in any module. For simplicity, in this talk, I will only consider coefficients in the adjoint representation. And so the space is the space of maps, linear maps, from which KG, or I would say from V tensor K to V, which are linear and anti-symmetric. And then the differential is defined by a simple formula, and there is no room here. A0 an is the sum for I going from 0 to n minus 1 to di ai f skipping I tensor an plus sum over I less than j f of plus minus 1 to di plus j ai aj tensor a0 skipping I and j tensor an. Okay. And now I want to redescribe exactly this notion of Lie algebra and of Lie algebra cohomology in terms of operands. And so first let me remind you what is an operand. And by operand, I will mean, which is a notion which goes back, I think, to May in the 70s. So an operand, by operand, I will mean linear, unital, symmetric, super operand. And what is it? It is a collection of vector superspaces. Which I will denote by Pn. And out with, together with a unity. Which is an element from the space P1, an action of the symmetric group on Pn, a right action the symmetric group on Pn, and composition maps. Which to elements from Pn, Pm1, and Pmn associate an element from Pm1 plus M2 plus Mn. And we will use the notation F of G1, G2. Gn, if f is in Pn, g1 in Pm1, and gn in Pm. Satisfying, and the axioms are the following. Well, we have a unity axiom, which says that f of 1, 1, 1, 1 is equal to f, which is also equal to 1 of f. Then we have a symmetry axiom, which says that if you take a composition and then you act with the symmetric group with an element from Sn to F, an element of from tau Sm1 to G1, and an element from Smn to Gn, this is the same as first composing and then acting with a certain element of the symmetric group, which I will denote sigma of tau 1 tau n, which is an element from S m1 plus m2 plus mn, which is easy to describe. So an element from this symmetric group should permute M plus M1 plus M2 plus Mn elements. Let me call Mn the sum of all of these. And this is Mn minus 1 plus 1. And so how do I permute? Very easy. I will use tau 1 to permute the first M1 numbers, tau 2 to permute the second M2, and tau n to permute the last Mn, and then I will use sigma to permute this kind of big subsets. And the resulting permutation is this, sigma of tau 1, tau 2, tau n. And then this is the symmetry axiom, and then there is the associativity axiom, which is the obvious axiom, namely, if you do f of g1 gn, which is an element of p of m1 plus mn, and then you compose it with h1, h2, hm1 plus mn, is the same as first acting with g1 on the first m1, with g2 on the second m2, and so on, and then at the end composing with f. Okay. I said that I define a super operator. Instead, I'm not using the superstructure here, but everything can be generalized to the supercase by adding some plus and minuses with the usual Quillen rule, that every time you change two of the elements, you put a minus sign. Okay. And now, the first obvious example is the so-called home operad of homomorphism, say V is a vector space, then I will define the home operand, home of V. I have to say what are the spaces P of N, so home of N is just the space of all linear maps from V tensor N to V. Then I have to say what is the unity. Well, when N equal 1, this is just endomorphisms of V. And therefore, you take the identity map. Then I have to say what is the right action of Sn. This is the obvious thing. You just let me write it with a formula. F sigma of V1 tensor Vn is defined as F applied to the permuted vectors. You permute the vectors by sigma. And then the composition maps is the obvious choice. I have to say what is F of G1 Gn, which should be a map, should be an element of Ohm of V tensor M1 plus Mn to V. So I have to apply to V1 tensor V M1 plus Mn, and I define it via the same formula that we wrote for the associativity. Okay. And then it's an easy exercise to show that all the axioms are satisfied. In fact, it's an obvious exercise. And another example that I want to introduce is the Lie operand. Is again an operand, so I have to say what are the spaces. This is defined by generators and relations. So I will say what is Li1. Li1 is just there's just the identity element. And Li2 is also one dimensional, generated by a single element that I will denote by beta. And on Li2, you need to have an action of S2. And so how does sigma act on beta? By changing sign. So beta. And then all the other Lien are defined starting with this by composing using compositions. Generated by beta, by compositions. imposing the opera axioms, of course, plus one extra relation. Which I will call Jacobi identity, which can be written as follows: beta of 1 beta minus beta of 1 beta 1 2, the cycle 1 2, is equal to beta of beta 1. And why I call it Jacobi identity? Because you should think of beta as the Lie bracket acting on two elements. And so with this interpretation, this can be thought as acting with the Lie bracket on the second and third elements, and then applying the Lie bracket on A and bracket of BBC. Then this is permuting A and B. And this is equal to acting first on the Lie bracket with on A and B, and then taking the Lie bracket with the third element. And this is just the usual Jacobi identity in a Lie algebra. Okay. And so this should suggest that exercise a Lie algebra bracket on a vector space V is the same thing as a morphism of operands from the operand Lie to the operand HOM of V, which maps the generator beta of the operand Lie to the Lie bracket of the vector space V. And in general, we can therefore talk about a Lie algebra structure associated to a certain operand. Definition: a Lie algebra structure associated to an operand P is, by definition, is a morphism of operand from Lie to P. And the advantage of this definition is that such a notion comes directly with the cohomology complex. We get the analog of Chevalier-Eilenberg cohomology complex. Which is as follows: the complex, the spaces of cochains, you need to take the nth vector space and then take fixed points with the sign, the elements which according to Sn act with the sign representations, namely the elements f in P of n such that f sigma is the sine of sigma times f, which in the case of the HOM opera is just skew symmetric maps from V tensor n to V. And the differential which I can denote by d beta, because it's associated to this to an element beta of P2. D beta is given by d beta f is the sum for sigma in Sn1. First, I'll write the formula and then I'll explain. Plus minus 1 to the n, sum for sigma in Sn2, or rather 2n minus 1, f of beta 1, 1, sigma inverse, where I need to say what are Sn1 and S2n minus 1. These are the Mn shuffles, so Smn is a subset of the group Sn plus n of Mn shuffles, namely the permutations such that sigma of 1, the first m entries are in the increasing order, and the last n plus n entries are in the decreasing order. Like when you shuffle a deck of cards. And now if you look at this formula, in the special case when P is the home operand, you exactly recover the Chevalier-Eilenberg differential. The first term is precisely written in the other sense. It's precisely F applied to, for example, when sigma is the identity, is F applied to A1 An, and then take the Lie bracket with An plus 1, which up to a sign is this. And this one for the home operand becomes F of A1, A2, tensor A3, An plus 1, which is precisely this term in the Chevalier-Eilenberg complex. Okay. Exercise d beta square is equal to 0, and so you get the corresponding cohomology. And so we get the corresponding Lie cohomology theory associated to a certain operand. Okay, and so what we want to do now is introduce new operands. And for each of them, we describe the corresponding Lie algebra structures associated to them. And we will recover in this way the notions of Lie conformal algebras, vertex algebras, and Poisson vertex algebras. And doing it this way, we get automatically the corresponding cohomology theories. Okay, so let me remind you what is a Lie conformal algebra. A Lie conformal algebra, V, is a vector space which in fact is a C of D module. So it should come with an endomorphism D. C is an arbitrary field. With a Lie bracket, which I call the lambda bracket. Lambda bracket. A lambda bracket for me is a map from V tensor V to polynomials in lambda with coefficients in V, satisfying the skew symmetry. Well, the usual skew symmetry for Lie algebra is BA is minus AB. And here I have to say what happens to lambda. the LSQ symmetry says that B lambda A is minus A minus lambda minus D B, where this D is acting on the coefficients of the polynomial. And Jacobi identity is the usual Jacobi identity for Lie algebras, and for Lie conformal algebras you have A lambda B mu C minus B mu A lambda C is A lambda B lambda plus mu C. So you have to be careful here and put lambda plus mu. And now I want to describe Lie conformal algebras as in terms of a certain operand, which will be the CHOM operand, the operand of conformal homomorphism. CHOM operand of V, where V now is not a vector space, it's a C of D module. And what is the CHOM operand? CHOM operand is the space of conformal homomorphisms from V tensor N to V. And what do I mean by this? So it's the space of maps from V tensor N. Instead of going to V, they go to polynomials in N variables modulo D plus lambda 1 plus lambda N. Meaning that whenever you have the sum of all the lambdas, you can replace by minus D, acting on the coefficients of the polynomial. Satisfying sesquilinearity, which they should be sesquilinear, meaning, so this I'll denote F lambda 1 lambda n. So F lambda 1 lambda n applied to something where you apply D on the ith factor, this D can come out as minus lambda I. So these are sesquilinear maps. Ah, because I forgot one of the axioms of Lie conformal algebra, which is sesquilinearity. Meaning that dA lambda B is minus lambda A lambda B, and A lambda dB is D plus lambda A lambda B. Jethro, why didn't you correct me? Okay. And so these are the spaces for this CHOM operand. And now we need to say what is the unity. Again, HOM1 is the space of maps from V tensor 1, namely V, to V of lambda modulo D plus lambda. But V of lambda modulo D plus lambda is again identified can be identified canonically with V. And so again, we get NV. And here we get the identity map. Now, how does Sn act on the CHOM operand? This is very simple. Not only we need to permute the vectors V1, Vn, but also we need to permute the lambdas, lambda 1, lambda n. And then the composition maps, they will have all these lambdas, and I have to say how they are the, how to put them on the right hand side of associativity. Well, this should be explained. So the usual associativity is F applied to G1 applied to the first M1 vectors, then G2 applied to the second M2 vectors, and so on. And now I have to say how the lambdas go. So G1, of course, will get the first M1 lambdas. G2, of course, will get the second M2 lambdas, and Gn, the last Mn lambdas. But then what lambdas should I put on F? On F, I will put lambda, big lambda 1, big lambda 2, big lambda n, where big lambda 1 is the sum of the first M1 lambdas. Lambda 2 is the sum of the second M2, and so on. So lambda 1 is lambda 1 plus lambda M1, and same for the others. And now, okay. And now, again, proposition, exercise, proposition as you want to call it. So first of all, CHOM is indeed an opera. And second of all, a morphism from the Lie opera to CHOM is exactly the same as a Lie conformal algebra structure on V, lambda bracket on V. So we recover the notion of a Lie conformal algebra. And the corresponding Lie algebra, the corresponding cohomology complex. Complex, which here I denoted by D bet, C of CHOM D beta. Is precisely what is known as the Lie conformal algebra cohomology. Which goes back to, I think, Bakalov, Katz, and Voronov. Bakalov, Katz, Voronov from 98 or 99. I wrote it down. No, 95. Okay. Okay, now we want to modify a bit this operand and construct a new operand, which I will call the chiral operand, whose Lie algebra structure associated will be the notion of a vertex algebra. Okay. So I should use another color. So again, V is a C of D module, and we want to introduce a new opera that we will call the chiral opera associated to V. In order to define it, again, first we need to define the spaces. P chiral of n. In order to define it, we need to introduce some notation first, some algebras of functions. So, notation, I will denote by On the algebra of polynomials in n variables, by ONT the translation invariant polynomials, namely polynomials in the differences. And by, so this is a subalgebra here, and by ON star T, kind of localization of these polynomials, namely Laurent polynomials in these differences. So these are translation invariant Laurent polynomials. And now the chiral operand, PN chiral, is the space of maps from V tensor N tensor ON star T to the same space, polynomials in N variables modulo D plus lambda 1 plus lambda N, satisfying. Sesquilinearity. I have to explain what sesquilinearity means. So this sesquilinearity axiom should be modified a bit. I'll do it here. There are two sesquilinearity conditions. One is very similar to this one. So if you look at this sesquilinearity condition for Lie conformal algebra, for the CHOM operand, you have that when you do F lambda 1 lambda n, and then apply D plus lambda I on the ith factor. Ah, you don't see? How about green? No, green is bad, worse. White, okay. Okay, white. But you know this stuff anyway. F lambda 1 lambda n. And you apply D plus lambda I on the ith factor. D plus lambda I on the ith factor. This sesquilinearity condition says that the result should be zero. But in for the chiral opera, this is not zero. It's just equal to the thing is that on the chiral opera, on the last factor, you need to put a function, which I will call it h of z1, zn. And here you need to take the derivative with respect to zi of this function. So, okay. This is the first sesquilinearity condition. And the second sesquilinearity condition says that it says what happens when, so this says what happens when you take the derivative of this function. And the second says what happens when you multiply this function by one of the generators, zi minus zj. And the answer is that you need to take whatever answer you have without this multiplication, and then take the derivative with respect to lambda j minus the derivative with respect to lambda I applied to the polynomial in lambdas. Note that If instead of on star t we put ont, instead of on star t we put ont, namely just polynomials, not Laurent polynomials, then first of all you can use the second axiom to say that it's enough to define f on the polynomial 1, because every other polynomial is obtained by this, the second sesquiniarity condition. On the other hand, when you put the polynomial 1, the derivative of 1 is 0. And so you recover exactly the CHOM operat. Okay? And so when instead of on star t you get on t, you get the CHOM operat, which defines Lie conformal algebra. Yes, it's a kind of explicit description of it.
I would have thought that there'd be kind of n minus 1 relations on the right hand side of your map, the diagonal for codimension n minus 1, where you have to put star and del 1 minus 1 to the right.
You mean this?
Yeah.
Can you say the question again? Okay. So far we only describe the spaces. Now we need to describe the rest of operat structure. So again, when you take n equal 1, this reduces to the nv for the same reason as before. And so you can take the identity map. Now, Raimundo doesn't like blue, so purple. So now this is very simple. I have to say how the symmetric group acts on such elements. Here you need to add this function h of z1 zn, and it's easy to guess how the action should be. You need to permute not only all the vectors, all the lambdas, also the variables z1 zn. And then composition maps are a bit messier to describe. So again, here you need to add a certain function h of all these variables, z1, zm1 plus mn. And here you will need to put some functions, h1, h2, hm, or let's change letter, p1, p2, pn. And here another function tensor, and tensor another function q of w1 wn. And I have to say how all these functions are defined, are constructed, and it's very easy to describe. So you want to write your function h, which has all these variables, m1 plus mn variables. And you can write it as a combination of functions p of all the variables, z1, zm1 plus mn, times q1 of z1, only the first m1 variables, Qn of only the last mn variables, with the conditions that this function Q has no poles at zi minus zj with I and j within the same width. So let me write it down. I and j both in the same string, namely either in the first M1 numbers or the second M2 numbers and so on. They should be kind of indifferent strings. Very well. And now you can do the same as we did for Lie conformal algebras. I noticed that it's strange that it's a kind of conference on vertex algebras, and so far nobody gave the definition of a vertex algebra. So let me give the definition of a vertex algebra. Definition: vertex algebra is a morphism of operands from the operand Lie to the operand P chiral of V. And then the good thing about this definition is that it comes for free with the cohomology theory associated to it. And so we get the corresponding vertex algebra cohomology. Which I don't write it because I wrote the general formula before for any operand. And then, of course, when one has to define a cohomology theory, the first one wants to understand what are the first cohomology groups and then compute cohomology in various examples. So first of all, what does this cohomology describe? H0 is what is called the space of Casimirs of V, namely the element from V mod dV whose Lie bracket on the rest of the vertex algebra is trivial. So let me at lambda equals 0 is equal to 0. H1 is derivations of the vertex algebra mod out by inner derivations. And H2 is extensions. Vertex algebra extensions from V to V plus V, where on the second V you put the 0 lambda bracket. And then one can try to compute vertex algebra cohomology for various examples. And the best way we know how to do this is going through its classical limit, namely going through Poisson vertex algebra cohomology. And so we want to define a filtration of this operand and then take associated graded, which will allow us to define a Poisson vertex algebra cohomology. So first of all, let's introduce some filtrations. So first of all, the space is O(n) star T are filtered as follows. We define F0 just what we call O(n)T, namely polynomials without poles. And then F1 is, namely this is polynomial. F1 is, you allow only one pole. Linear combination of polynomials with a single pole. with pole on a single poles on a single diagonal. And then F2 with poles on two diagonals and so on. And then let's also assume that V assume that also the C of the module V has a filtration, increasing filtration. And then we get the corresponding decreasing filtration of the chiral operand defined as follows. What is FR P chiral of V? So we said these are maps from V tensor N tensor ON star T to polynomials in N variables. Okay, and then we have to say how it behaves with the filter spaces. So if you put here S1 filter space, FN filter space, FSN filter space, and FT filter space here, it should map to the filter space associated to the number sum of all these values, S1 plus S2 plus Sn plus T minus R. So this R is the same as this R. And so it's a decreasing filtration. And this makes P chiral into a filtered operand, and you can take the associated graded. Which can axiomatize it and to get the corresponding what we call the PV classical operand. Get the notion of so-called classical operand associated to a graded C of the module V, which we can describe explicitly, which we could describe explicitly if we had 5 more minutes. It's more or less. Oh, just a couple of minutes. Okay. So this can have a very explicit description, combinatorial description in terms of graphs. Which I will skip, but what I want to say is that then we get exactly the same theorem that as a morphism from Li to chiral operand gives vertex algebra, a morphism to Li to the classical operand gives is the same as a Poisson vertex algebra structure on V. So. Morphism from Li to the classical opera Don V is the same as a Poisson vertex algebra structure on V. Moreover, let me write it correctly. There is a, so this is theorem one. Theorem two, for every filter C of D module V, there exists a canonical injective morphism of operads from the associated graded of the chiral operad of V to the classical operad of the associated graded of V, which and this is an isomorphism provided that V is graded as a C of D module. And this allows us to relate the cohomology of vertex algebra to the cohomology of the corresponding Poisson vertex algebra. And so, by spectral sequences argument, say corollary, we get a bound on the vertex algebra cohomology given by the Poisson vertex algebra cohomology if V is a vertex algebra. And therefore, to compute vertex algebra cohomology is useful to compute Poisson vertex algebra cohomology, which luckily is a little bit easier to compute. And so we use this fact to compute cohomology for several examples. For example, I will only write the results. For the free boson vertex algebra, so say V of H is the free boson vertex algebra associated to a space of bosons H. And so the vertex algebra cohomology is wedge nh O plus wedge n plus 1 h. So for the free fermion vertex algebra, example 2. So say F is free fermion vertex algebra, then its cohomology is only non-zero unless n is equal to 0, 2, or 3. Unless n is 0, and it's one-dimensional for n equal to 1. And for Virasoro vertex algebra, is 0 unless n is 0, 2, or 3, and it's one-dimensional for n equal 0, 2, or 3. And for the universal affine vertex algebra, this is isomorphic to Hn Gc plus Hn plus 1 Gc, cohomology for the Lie algebra G. Sorry for running late.
Okay, so are there any questions?
So you said 82 is a deformation.
Yes.
So what is a deformed Virasoro algebra for this case?
H2
is one dimension, so you have a family of deformation of Virasoro vertex algebra.
It's a good question. I have to think about it.
Okay.
Other questions?
Hey, in analogy with the Chevalier-Eilenberg complex, like you were talking about in the beginning, is it true that these cohomologies are like the image of the kind of, you know, A as a module over itself under some like derived functor of invariance, like from, you know, A mod to vector?
Yeah. It's another good question. I think so, but this point of view has not been fully developed.
Right.
For homology.
For homology.
Oh. Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay. Other questions? Okay, so if not, let's thank the speaker again. Yeah.